This is the story of Loganair Flight 670 Alpha. It was the 27th of February 2001. The night was cold, just 1 degree over freezing, or 34 degrees Fahrenheit. A short 360-100 landed at Edinburgh Airport after completing the day's flight. The plane taxied to the stands, where it would spend the rest of the night. Before heading out for the night, they refueled the plane with 3,000 pounds, or 1,300 kilos, of fuel. The plane needed to head back out at 4 a.m., so fueling the plane now would save time for the next crew. But Mother Nature had other plans for the crew and the plane. By 2 a.m., the airport was closed as a result of severe weather. The snow pounded the airport, and winds of up to 43 knots battered the planes. By 6 a.m., the crew were told that the airport would not open for a few more hours, so the crew made the best of the situation. They secured the plane the best that they could. They put straps on the propellers, covered up the pitot tubes, and then retired to the crew room to get out of the biting cold. The wind and the snow did not let up until 10 a.m. By 3 p.m., they were ready to take the plane from Edinburgh to Belfast. This was a flight that was delayed by the storm. They started the engines, but immediately they had some issues. The right-hand engine was working intermittently. The crew tried their best, but soon they had to ask for engineering assistance. The generator in the right-hand engine just would not work. The engineer made the changes and ran the engine for about 15 minutes to see if the fix had worked. They ran the engine for another 15 minutes just to double check. The engine worked fine. Before the engineer left, the engineer checked the oil levels and checked the surface of the plane for ice. The oil levels were fine, and there wasn't a whole lot of ice on the surface of the plane. With that, the engines were started, and both engines functioned for about 20 minutes at the stands with no issues. By 5:10 p.m., the plane was taxiing to runway 06. As they taxied, they went through the checklist. Icing was a concern that was on the pilots' minds. The captain wanted to cycle the landing gear once they were in the air to make sure that it was free of ice and slush. That's the kind of things that they talked about as they taxied. The plane took off. As they had talked about before, the captain cycled the landing gear to get rid of any ice on them. The gears were retracted and then extended and then retracted again. As the plane breached 1,200 feet, they pulled back the engines to climb power. As they did that, the crew carried out the after takeoff checks on the plane. The captain asked the first officer to turn on all the anti-icing systems. The captain was busy tuning to the Scottish ATCC, and the first officer was busy flipping switches. As the switches were flipped, both engines died. They had just suffered a dual engine flameout at 2,200 feet. The captain immediately put out a mayday call. Quote, "Mayday, mayday, mayday. This is Logan 670 Alpha. We've had a double engine failure. Repeat, a double engine failure." End quote. The captain turned the plane towards the coastline and let the speed drop down to 110 knots. They were descending at 2,800 feet per minute. At this point, they realized that they'd be ditching in the water. The first officer made a radio call to let ATC know that they'd be ditching, but this was never received by ATC. As they got closer and closer to the water, the captain started to pull the nose up. The plane impacted the surface of the water at 86 knots in a nose-high attitude. The plane came to rest 65 meters from the shore in water that was 6 meters deep. None of the two pilots survived. The first suspect was the weather. The weather had been very bad leading up to the takeoff, but when they took off, the weather was calm. So the weather at the time of the takeoff was ruled out. In this case, both engines flamed out at the very same time. So something affected the engines together. Something that they looked at was ice blocking a fuel vent, but that theory was quickly dismissed. The ice in the fuel vent could not block the flow of fuel as the diameter of the pipes were low. They then looked at the engines themselves for mechanical faults, but this was very unlikely. What are the odds of two engines having mechanical problems at the exact same time? Tearing the engines down, they found no signs of mechanical failure. The engines were fine. They then looked at the possibility of the engines icing up. Sure, the pilots de-iced the plane and the weather was relatively good, but ice could have snuck into the engines. You see, during the night, the plane was parked into the wind and the engine's inlets were not covered up. so there is a possibility that the wind may have driven snow and ice deep into the engine. Well, that's the idea anyway. So they built a test to see if that could actually happen. They used another short 360 to see if surface winds could reach deep into the engines. They found that 30 knot winds could easily reach deep into the engine. So, during the night before the flight, as the plane braved the storm, the wind was sending snow and ice deep into the chambers of the engine. To understand why this is a problem, we have to look at the engines that's used on the Shorts 360. The air is sent through an intake and then through a mesh, and it finally reaches the plenum chamber. This is where ice accumulated overnight. But the Short 360 has anti-ice vanes designed to keep ice out of the engine, right? Yes, the Short 360 has systems designed to protect the engines from ice. The air intake has an electrical heating system designed to prevent icing. In addition to that, it has an inertial separator inside the engine. In the air intake path, there are two vanes. Vanes as in moving metal sheets, not vanes as in veins in the body. The vanes are a part of the inertial separation system. When the anti-icing vanes are deployed, they extend into the airflow in the engine's air inlet path. When this happens, the snow and ice are redirected out of the engine and only air goes into the mesh and the chamber. That's how the anti-icing system on the Shorts 360 works. On the accident flight, they noticed that the engines flamed out after the pilots engaged the anti-icing vanes in the engines. But there's no way that the engine was iced up in flight, right? I mean, the engines were turned on and they ran for quite some time on the ground. So, even if the engine had been iced up, the ice would have been melted away by the heat of the engine. Or that's what you'd think. The investigators found that when the engine warmed up, it indeed did melt the ice, and it turned into slush and it flowed down. But once it came down, it came into contact with the cold wind that was forcing its way into the engine inlet. At this point, the wind was at about 16 knots. Also, the engine was being run intermittently, so slush accumulated at points inside the engine, and the cold wind prevented the residual heat from the engines from melting the slush. Right now, the air intake of both engines are contaminated with ice and slush. Not good. Once the plane started its takeoff run, the air pushed the slush back, all the way back to the anti-icing vanes. Now, after the plane had taken off, as it was climbing, the captain knew that they'd encounter some icing in the clouds, so he asked the first officer to enable the anti-icing vanes. With slush pushed up against the vanes, when the vanes extended, it dug into the slush, kind of like a snowplow, and the vanes and the slush drastically reduced the airflow into the engine. With slush disrupting the airflow into the engines flamed out. Now, you might be asking, how do we know that this is exactly what happened? Good question. For one, each engine failed 3.95 seconds after its corresponding anti-ice switch was flipped. On top of that, the motor that drove the vanes created a very specific kind of electrical noise that the CVR picked up. They compared what they heard on the CVR to their test bench, and both samples matched up perfectly. So they know that the vanes were working that day. So, now we know. A bit of ice in the engines that no one could find caused the flameouts. So now the question becomes, how could this have been prevented? Well, plugs for the engine inlets would have done the job. It would have prevented the ice and snow from getting into the engine. The manufacturer's maintenance manual called for the engine inlets to be sealed up during times of rough weather. But the operator's manual did not call for that. The operator's manual said that the plugs had to be used if the plane was parked for, quote, any length of time, end quote. That's pretty vague and was generally interpreted to mean an overnight stop. Remember, as per the original schedule, the plane was supposed to go back up in a few hours. But even if they wanted to secure the engines, the airline did not provide the crew with the plugs and they were not readily available at the airport. It seems that no one thought of ice contaminating the engine in this way. In addition to that, they found loopholes in the training of the pilots. In case of a water ditching, the pilots were trained to use an emergency hatch and life vests, but this wouldn't really work if the cockpit was submerged, as was the case this time around. Also, the operations manual did not have a procedure that these pilots could have followed. Quote, they attempted a ditching at the slowest possible speed, and attained a similar attitude to to that recommended for the power available case, end quote. It is very concerning that something as simple as how a plane is parked can lead to complications and accidents. How do you think accidents like these can be avoided? Do let me know in the comments below. Thank you for watching this episode of Mini Air Crash Investigation. If you like the videos that I make, do consider liking and subscribing. It will really help the channel grow. I will catch you guys next time. Stay safe.